साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्व प्रचोदयात्। ओम साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्व प्रचोदयात्। ओम साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्व प्रचोदयात्। ओम साई राम एंड गुड इवनिंग टू वन एंड ऑल। थैंक यू फॉर जॉइनिंग दिस गोविंद सीरीज विच स्टार्टेड अ ईयर अगो। आई थिंक वी आर इन आवर 64th सत्संग कंसेक्यूटिवली and thanks to Swami, every week we have one of his gem coming in, and this week he says, I'll give you a bonanza. And there are three gems, as we call the alumni or students of Swami's college, addressing us as a family. And I'm as excited as you are to know more about them and to hear from them. So I'm going to leave my brother Vivek to do the introduction of the speakers for today.
Om Sri Sai Ram, offering my loving salutations at the Eternal Mother's lotus feet. Thank you all for joining us for this Govind series. As Venkat had put it, it's almost a year plus, and he's keeping the count. We are grateful and indebted to Swami for allowing us to continue this week after week. Sometimes it becomes difficult. We have last minute cancellation of speakers, and then we start hunting for speakers. So, yeah, and it is wonderful to connect with so many alumni and devotees, albeit virtually. We have been fortunate to have this connect with Swami and experience his divine love, teachings, and his greatness through these sharing sessions of these wonderful speakers. So, in a sense, it's been like a mini Satyam Shivam Sundaram series with alumni from the first batch in Vrindavan. And I think in the speaker series, I think the last that we had was as late as 2010. And now Srinivasan has brought in a new edition of a current secondary school student. So, you know, the generations definitely keep panning. And today I have the privilege of introducing this alumni couple, Sister Soumya Srinivasan and his son, who is presently in the secondary school in Prashanthi Nilayam. So Sister Soumya did her BA and MA in English Literature from Swami's University from the years 2000 to 2005. She subsequently went on to do her MPhil at Malagappa University. She's presently an assistant professor in the Department of English at SRM Institute of Science and Technology, the Vadapalani campus in Chennai, and her research interests include Middle East studies and feminist studies. As for Srinivasan, I think I will take the liberty of introducing him informally. So he is a fellow batchmate of Pavan and me, and he did his BCom from 94 to 97 from the Vrindavan campus. So if I have to describe Srinivasan, it's an extremely cheerful person. And you can all see that smile, you know, his smile lightens the atmosphere, and so does his witty jokes. So he has carried it well into his corporate ladder and has worked for companies like Wipro, and currently heads the learning and developmental team of HCL in Chennai. Their families have been devotees, both their families have been devotees since the 1960s. And I'm given to understand that they are all actively involved in Balvikas and all the service activities by their samitis in Chennai. Pawan, if you can add in a few words, and then I will let Soumya, Srinivasan, the trio take over and started from
here. Sairam all, offering my humble pranams at Swami's lotus feet. As you all said, Srinivasan is for everybody. We call him as Kadlur, as a nickname. And Srinivasan is extremely talented cricketer. Had fortunate enough to do the opening innings with him. And most of the time we used to chat more on the cricket field rather than in hostel. And he was my opening buddy partner on the cricket field. And coming to
incidentally, we were roommates in the first year, and I continued to be his roommate in the second year too.
Yeah. So, and coming to his personality, he is extremely humble and extremely cheerful and extremely service-oriented mentality. And he has been very anchoring in many of the service activities. He takes part wherever opportunity is given. And I have seen him personally in hostel days. He has done a lot of service, name it in the hostel kitchen or, you know, general wards where he used to participate. And then I really appreciate that he has been very humble and not like, coming on to the kind of a limelight or anything, but he used to keep his profile very low, but extremely he is doing very well in the corporate side and also going around various institutes and giving corporate speeches as well as the Balvika speeches to the young children, which is motivating factor. And his son is extremely talented. I've seen him playing cricket in primary school. And I think he has graduated himself to the higher secondary school. I wish him all the best. And so this is what...
Wonderful harmonium and harmonium player and a singer. We have forgotten to introduce that part.
Yes, that part of it. So he's extremely talented.
And also a good debater, I presume.
Yeah. So he has got sports skills from his father. I think I'm sure harmonium and singing skills from his mother, I'm sure. So I think this is where...
Probably the oratory skills too.
And then he's becoming our next two. And then he will be the next budding star from the higher secondary school. Wish you all the best, Sairam.
Over to you both. Over to you three.
Thank you so much, brothers. I think this is the first time I'm hearing certain facts. Thank you so much for a kind gesture. And it is really wonderful being a part of such a satsang. And in the current scenario, we are very, very blessed enough to be thinking about Swami and talking about Swami, spending our time this way, while the world is going through a lot of turmoil. We pray to the world to come back to its normalcy soon in the way of this, satsang. Thank you so much for a kind gesture, dear brothers and sisters. And To start off this satsang, one thing I wanted to start off with is how I came to Swami. Swami entered my life since my birth, when my parents and grandparents introduced Swami as my God. And that's how Swami came into my life since birth. And, several times I felt that Swami is like my mother. Not like my mother, he's my mother, father, everything. Guru, guide. So as all of us would have felt at many times in life. And several times my mother had this worry. Like any other mother, like how my son will fare in his life. And, she's so, loving towards me that she kept on worrying. My father was very confident that I will somehow, come into the groove that Swami is, molding me. But my mother always kept on worrying about me, whether how my life would be. And in one such point in life, my Swami came in my mother's dream, and then he gave an assurance. So he gave an assurance in such a way that she did not even worry about me after that dream. In that dream, Swami had told my mother that don't ever worry about your son. And this is the same tone that she told me. don't ever worry about your son. He is my son more than your son. I will take care of him. And that was the assurance given by Swami to my mother. The way that Swami would have told her, she did not even worry a second about me after that. And that was an assurance given to me, to my mother, as well as it was a great learning for me. Whenever I had to go through troubles, whenever I need to take a few decisions in my life, I always, this thing ring in my mind or ring in my ear every single time that Swami is my parent. Why do I worry? Even though, you know, both my parents had left to Swami's abode, but still I believe that Swami is still guiding me and molding me more than ever. So that is the assurance. That assurance stays with me till today. And that is something that I wanted to start off with. And second thing is, we both were me and my wife were married by divine will, his divine will. And it all happened through his divine experience.
It actually so happened that my mother was performing her seva in Puttaparthi, and one of her co-sevadals and she, they were talking, and I had gone to Puttaparthi that time in November to for my MA gold medal, to receive my MA gold medal from Swami's hands. And that's when my mother and the co-sevadal, they had a conversation in which my mother was telling me that I have a daughter who needs to get married. I need to get her married off to someone, and she's very keen that she wants to get married to a Swami's devotee. And this conversation just built on, and then they parted ways. And after coming back to Chennai, my mother gets a call from my mother-in-law saying that such and such a person had shared your number with me, saying you have a daughter. And my son is also an alumnus of Bhagwan's Institute. And that's how the entire family came together. So virtually we feel that the alliance was fixed at Swami's divine lotus feet itself, where performing Swami's duties, Swami takes care of our families. You know, the responsibility that my parents had and his parents had to marry us off to someone. And that came to a very lovely close where we started our journey together. Walking on Swami's path, Swami's sayings.
So what happened after that is, she mentioned that it is as per divine will that he has selected the match. And after which, you know, I had the desire that Swami should perform our wedding. So I went to Parthi and Swami blessed our wedding. But at that particular point of time, Swami was in wheelchair, and I always wanted to ask Swami whether you could perform, whether we will be blessed to that you perform our marriage. So, but that did not happen. But Swami blessed. I came back, and then we continued with our wedding. And during the wedding, we always believed that Swami's presence was always there, and we kept on praying at every moment during the wedding that Swami should show his presence. So we felt his omnipresence every single moment during the wedding. But again, I had this desire, if not Swami perform our wedding physically, if he could bless both of us as a couple, standing together as a couple. So we thought, I had this desire, and that went on. We went to Vrindavan after our wedding, but we are all aware, we used to sit separately in gents as well as in ladies. But so we did not have any opportunity to stand together as a couple and seek Swami's blessings, though we know that Swami had blessed us. But this kind of silly desire that I had, that Swami should somehow bless us as a couple. So as this went on, that was the time when Swami visited Chennai in 2006 to perform the Atirudra Mahayagna, so army. So Swami came to Sundaram, and the Atirudra Mahayagna was performed in the nearby place in Tiruvanmiyur. So we wanted to, there was nothing in our mind that except having a darshan of Swami. So we started off one fine day morning as Swami willed it. So we started off, we wanted to have Swami's darshan. So we planned to go to either to the venue or to Sundaram. So that was there in our mind. Then we took a chance. As Swami willed it, we wanted to go to Sundaram and have darshan of Swami. We did not know whether Swami is there or not. He might be there in the venue as well. So we took a chance, went to Sundaram. And while we were entering that Sundaram road, we saw that, you know, people are, devotees were all waiting on the either side of the road, on the pavement. Then we got to understand that, you know, Swami might be on his way to somewhere. Then we sensed that Swami is going to come out or he is going to come in. So what we thought, we parked the vehicle by the side and we all stood, I mean, we both stood together. So, but we did not expect Swami at that particular point of time. So while we were standing together, just outside the Sundaram gate, slowly Swami's car came out and the Swami was passing by both of us. And that was a beautiful sight that to see Swami as he was passing by both of us, he smiled at us and showed Abhayasta. And, you know, literally we were stunned. We were, words cannot express that smile. So it was like, it gave me an indication when I am there listening to you all the time as your Hridaya Vihari, why do you worry? Even the slightest of desires that you have, I am here to fulfill. And that was the indication that Swami had given at that particular point of time, that Abhayasta he had shown with a smile. It made me understand.
Conveys few, more number of meanings than our little minds could actually comprehend. Beyond everything, it's just beyond words, beyond our comprehension. That's the divine will and the divine mother's love for her children. So to that divine mother, we offer our most humble pranams through a song, which is going to be sung by our son, Sai Charan.
पूछो ना कैसी है मेरी माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ। अरे पूछो ना कैसी है साई माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ। मेरे बदन में जान है तू माँ, मिले मुझे किस्मत से ऐसी माँ। ओ साई तेरे चरणों में खिलते, तेरे उपवन में वृंदावन के फूल है माँ, तुम में समा जाए माँ। वृंदावन के फूल है माँ, तुम में समा जाए माँ। दिल में बसने वाली साई माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ। अरे पूछो ना कैसी है साई माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ, एक सच्ची दोस्त जैसी माँ.
One thing that we always wanted to sow as a seed in our son's heart was the love for Swami, and to think of him as the only one, as the only compassionate, the most intimate one, and to always try, when given a choice in life, try to choose God always, try to choose Swami always as your first priority. This is something that we learned at Bhagwan's portals, and we wanted to pass it on to Swami. One incident from my life was, it could be I wouldn't say insignificant, but nevertheless, not something that could be really, you know, awed at, but a very personal experience. During my college days, some of us got special permission from our teachers to stay back during the winter vacation in Puttaparthi itself. So on one such occasion when we were there in Puttaparthi, especially why we chose the winter vacation time was, most of the girls would leave for their homes, and then only a handful of us would stay back there, and the students' block would be exclusively for us, and so that we could get special attention from Swami. Unlike brothers of Vrindavan or Puttaparthi, students, Anantapur girls always had, you know, very rare occasions where we could reach out to Swami, or we could have one-on-one interaction with Swami. So we always were on the lookout to grab such an opportunity. So this was one time where we could really get that chance, where just maybe a handful of 20, 30 of us would be there in the block. So one such time, when I was a student, such things were told by our seniors. So I was also like, okay, let me also stay back during the vacation so that I could interact with. So I would get an opportunity to interact, and we would continuously pray for that. So one day when Swami came for darshan, he looked at our block. Almost 3/4 of it was empty. Just 1/4 of it was occupied by us. And then Swami asked, Everu, then we said, Swami, Anantapur student Swami. Then he went, and then once he went inside, he came back with baskets of wood apples. And then he called our warden, and then he told, give it to my girls who are sitting in the block. So when teachers came and distributed those bags of wood apples to us, they said, Swami has sent you saying, give it to my girls. So just imagine, you have chosen Swami. It's not that the others have not chosen Swami, because I'm sure all of you know that Swami insists students should go back home to do seva to their parents, to please their parents. But nevertheless, Swami inspired us to stay back here. But then he also conveyed the message that you chose me as to spend your time with these 10-15 days, and I have given you this prasadam, I recognizing you that you are all there for me here. So that one instance had a great impression on me, and that's one thing that we always wanted to pass it on to Sai Charan also, to choose Swami as your first priority.
On the same lines, I was just I'm recollecting one particular incident where choosing Swami, it's a life lesson that I learned at Prashanthinilayam. Might be in the year 1996, to be more precise, as we had been to Prashanthinilayam for one special occasion. And Swami used to give, for those who had not experienced that, Swami used to come for darshan around 7 o'clock in the morning and go around the Sai Kulvantal. And then after giving darshan, he will pick up a handful of devotees to the for an interview. And by the time Swami gets into the interview room, after everyone goes inside the interview room, Swami was the one who always go last into the interview room. So when he shuts the door from inside, you know, we take a quick break. So all those who had not completed our breakfast, so we would utilize that particular time to have our breakfast or any other work, and then we'll come back as soon as we complete those work. So we used to disperse, might be around 1 hour or 1.5 hours. So might be as Swami willed it, I was the only student sitting on the lower portico of the Sai Kulonthal. The for those would not know, the lower portico is something at the back side of, I mean, where Samadhi is right now. So where Swami car is always used to, whenever Swami comes around in Sai Kulonthal, that's the place where Swami parks his car. And upper portico is just opposite to the interview room and just outside the bhajan hall. So I was sitting in the lower portico, and there were mats spread across everywhere for the students to sit. But all those students had gone out for breakfast or various other reasons, and I was the only one sitting there. Maybe not, that's not intentional, but Swami willed it that way. So there were a lot of guests sitting on the upper portico, and there was one guest, one gentleman from from some other country. I believe it's from Russia or somewhere, Italy. So he was sitting just next to me on the upper portico. So I was going through some book, and Swami normally he used to open the interview room door might be for 40 minutes, after 40 minutes or 1 hour. But that day, Swami came back so quickly. He finished the interview for one group of devotees, and they had been like leaving the interview room. And when they leave, Swami used to make a quick tour around. And then until the next group gets in, and then Swami would wait and chit chat here and there. So in that situation, on that day, I was sitting, and as I could see, you know, I could sense Swami opening the interview room door. I was just looking at Swami, and Swami was looking around, and he was straight coming to the place where I was sitting. So he stood right in front of me, and he saw me and the gentleman who was sitting on the upper portico, sitting next to me. So as Swami was having, you know, casual interaction with him, so he discussed about his family, he discussed about his secrets, and all those were happening. And all of a sudden, Swami got so angry during the conversation. And that is something that I couldn't, assimilate, because that's the first time I'm seeing Swami with angry looks. And just, I was holding Swami's feet, and I was looking about Swami's reaction. And while Swami was angry, he was blasting that foreign gentleman to the core, and he was pushed to the corners. And I did not know what was happening. And all of a sudden, that gentleman was crying, and he was telling Swami in a very, very, lower tone, that he has brought some gifts. And I believe that conversation was something like the gentleman has smuggled some goods in the name of Swami while coming to Prashantralayam. So Swami was having that kind of, you know, conversation with him not to do that. And this gentleman was offering his help to Swami by telling that, "Swami, I have brought some gifts and pen to your students." And Swami was looking around with a very, very angry face. And the person I was just sitting at the right at the feet of Swami, he looked me straight through my eyes with an angry tone. "Hey, take that pen. Do you want that pen?" Then I was telling that, "Swami, no, Swami. I did not know how to react, because that's the first time I'm seeing Swami in a very close quarters with an angry face. And then next time Swami asked me, "Go, he's giving pen." He was telling in Telugu. "So go, he's giving pen, take it." And then I said, no, Swami. I just held my hand like this, and I was telling, "No, Swami." And immediately the profound statement, and that is the life lesson. I'm not sure whether the foreign gentleman had learned this lesson, but that was a straight lesson for me. And Swami had told, "See, my boys, they don't aim for your cheap pens. They want Swami." And that was the first lesson that was given to, I'm not sure whether it's for the foreigner, but it was for me. And that stays with me till today. Whenever I'm going through any kind of trouble, whenever I'm going through any kind of, when I need Swami most, that was the thing that come to my mind, that, you know, I am there for you. You are asking only for me. I am there for you. So that helps in my, daily life till today.
Another lesson that I learned from my school days is that if we pray for something with a good intention to Swami, Swami will surely fulfill it. And 2 years back, I was in my seventh standard in Swami's primary school. And it was Christmas time. We were practicing for the upcoming sports meet for January 11th. And I was a part of the tabla group. And I was called for the audition for the performance to be conducted on Christmas Day, December 25th. So, but unfortunately, I was not selected for the tabla audition. But actually, there should be some percussion instruments which will be accompanying the tabla. So I prayed to Swami fervently that, Swami, please, I want to, if not for tabla, I want to play these accompanying instruments. And the next day, that night, I prayed to Swami that I wanted to play these percussion instruments. And the next day, when we were in practice, our tabla sir called us to school. And only the first three boys who came to the room where tabla sir called us would get the percussion instruments and the chance to play them. And by Swami's grace, I was one of the three. And I went on December 25th morning, I played a percussion instrument in front of Swami. And I learned from this incident that because I prayed with full faith, fervently to Swami made me play in front of him during Christmas.
Whenever Sai Charan shares his experiences, such experiences where Swami showered his grace on him, he got an opportunity to perform in the prayer hall, sing in the bhajans, sing during prayer bhajans, and perform before Swami Samadhi. We simply get transported to our times when we used to yearn for Swami's interactions with Swami, Swami's darshan. So it was one such time when it was almost some 2-3 months we had not visited Parthi, and maybe probably because Swami was in Vrindavan for the first 2 months, and then later on he came a little late, and so we really didn't have the opportunity to visit Parthi. So the yearning in our hearts grew so much that all of us had special bhajans. We used to have room bhajans. And so we started praying to Swami to call us for some on some or the other pretext, either for a function, festival, or just like that to, you know, he could send message to through our warden to bring all the girls to Puttaparthi. So the yearning for Swami grew and grew. And my personal experience on this was, one day I was singing this bhajan, darsh dikhao mere sai nandana. I was singing this bhajan and I was going to take my shower, and our bathrooms had it was closed from all sides. So as I went inside and I was singing this bhajan, I saw a butterfly, an orangish yellow butterfly, simply flying inside the bathroom. So I was wondering that Swami was giving me darshan there, because I was asking him to give his darshan as Nandalala. Swami had come in the form of a yellowish orange butterfly. The butterfly simply stuck to the wall throughout I sang the bhajan. And once I came out of the bathroom, after having my shower, I just wanted to check if the butterfly was still there on the wall. I came out of the bathroom, I just peeped in, the butterfly was no more. So it is such a beautiful experience that stays with me even today. It might be very minuscule, but then the essence of the experience that shows that anytime your pining for God is at the peak, you express it in the form of words, in the form of bhajan, or just a conversation with Swami. Swami responds to us the most, I would say, the loveliest way ever possible.
And on the similar lines, I too, on one particular, it happened a couple of years back. On a Holy Thursday, I had the opportunity every day we listen to Radio Sai, and I was listening to Radio Sai, and that day there was a reading of Shirdi Sai Sacharitra. So I was just going through that reading, and all of a sudden I had that pining for Swami's beautiful form, and I was so into it, and I need to go through my daily routine. So while I was thinking and I was attending my daily routine, I just took my bike and I was traveling at one particular street. All of a sudden, from nowhere, one lady, she was looking very, very pious, and she forcibly stopped me. And as if, if you don't stop, I'm going to chase you. Likewise, she forcibly stopped me, and I don't have any other choice than to stop. And she asked me, she was very pious with a big, forehead mark, and with a lot of flowers, with kumkum manjal everywhere. And she asked me, in fact, she ordered me that, I was asking her, what do you want, madam? And then she was literally ordering me that, please take me to Shirdi Baba temple. So Shirdi Baba temple is somewhere very near to her home. And I didn't have any other choice than to react. That was the tone. So I told her, I obliged her, you can sit in the back seat. And without any thought, I told her. And she got up on the back. She was a pillion rider. When I started the vehicle, I never felt any kind of, there is a person sitting behind me, the kind of, burden kind of weight. And I was literally like looking at the side view mirror to check whether the lady is there behind. Yes, she was looking at somewhere, and she was traveling along with me. And the Shirdi Baba temple had come, and then I stopped the vehicle gently, and she got down. When she got down, she asked me, don't you want to come inside the temple? And then I told, no, madam, I am going in for some other urgent work. And then I replied, she walked away, and I turned my vehicle. While I was turning my vehicle, something prompted me from within, look back. That was the voice that I heard, inner voice I heard. Immediately I turned, and I just couldn't believe my eyes, and that will stay with me for my life. When I turned towards that direction, she was climbing up the staircase of the temple, looking at me with a smiling face. That smile, it's nothing but, the way that Swami smiled at me. That was the smile as she was, climbing up the staircase of the temple with a smile, and she was looking at me. And all of a sudden, she disappeared in air. It is like, ash getting, literally mixing with the air, kind of, feeling. I was shaken, literally shaken. And, I have seen, we all have seen Swami materializing from the thin air. And this was the first time in my life I had seen the whole body is getting disappeared in the thin air. And that was the experience I never can forget in my life. So this shows that, when we pine for Swami's form, we had spent many number of years with Swami in a close proximity with him, and we pine for Swami's beautiful form. So when I pined on that particular day, the pining was such that he showed me in some other form, and listened to my prayers.
So very often we keep thinking, why does Swami give us such experiences? To acknowledge, maybe to raise us to his level, to that level of consciousness. There's so many such reasons, but we could never actually reason out. It's the only thing that we can do is experience it. And being in Swami, having studied in Swami's institution, we always wanted Sai Charan also to be a part of Bhagwan's institution. And so initially when we wanted to put him in his first standard, he was like, he was not too comfortable there. So did not give his consent on his own. So we thought we'll give him some time. So when he is ready mentally, when Swami wants him to be ready, he will automatically consent to join a hostel. So when he was in his fifth standard, we tried asking him, would you like to make up your mind to join Swami's school in sixth standard? So during his fifth itself, he started thinking about it. And we were in turn praying to Swami that he should join Bhagwan's, or rather Swami should accept him as a student in Bhagwan's institution. And that's how in sixth standard, when we applied, there was a lot of confusion regarding admission as usual. In a primary school, it's not that easy unless Bhagwan wills. So though I was an alumni of primary school also, we really had some confusion there whether he would really get through the exam and get through the interview and get a seat there. So when I told Sai Charan that kind of lost hope, said told him like, Sai, let's leave for Chennai because I don't think so it's going to really happen. He said, Amma, no, just wait for this one night. He had taken up his own sadhana for the 1 week that we were there on his own. We never told him do some sadhana, but he just took up sadhana on his own. He started chanting Gayatri, then Sai Gayatri. Then he went around the Shanmukha Sannadhi every day after darshan. So he did his own sadhana, kept maunam for 1 hour and so on. So the intensity with which he prayed to get an admission in Bhagwan's institution was also high. And maybe probably that's how Swami told through him to stay for that one particular night. I said, okay, so let me not book ticket for that night. So we'll stay this night, but tomorrow this is going to repeat. I think we'll go back to Chennai. And fortunately, that was the D-Day when Muni Aunty called me and she said that, get your son, let him write the entrance exam. And the next day he was selected. They asked him a couple of questions. And then finally, she told me to get his tests done in the hospital. So his admission into the school itself was so miraculous. And I feel that was the answer that Swami gave him for all the yearning and prayer that he had. So that is one thing that we could really pass on to him. Yearn for Swami, pray to him with all your faith. And faith can never be half or quarter. So pray to him with faith and definitely he would answer. And that is what I think he experiences also today. When we look at the education system that Swami's institution offers, even today when it's turned online, I don't think so there has been any change, except that the atmosphere, the physical atmosphere, the ambience has changed where he's taking it at the comfort of his own house. But I would say that there is as such no difference at all the way teachers take classes. Yes or no?
Yeah.
Why don't you tell them?
Some of our teachers in the higher secondary school, this is the first time I am meeting these higher secondary school teachers, and that too in online platform. And so I recognize this, some of my teachers, like my maths teacher. Maths is a subject which needs a board to explain equations and other stuff. And my maths teacher, he is a very old person. He's an aged person. And aged people and middle-aged people, they don't have much, they don't need to be
technically sound.
So my maths teacher, even though it is tough for him to teach online and ask questions online, he's adapting to the online platform so that he teaches us and molds us. And I recognized and I felt that all my teacher's intention was to mold us into proper Swami students and ideal Swami students. Now my teachers, the syllabus has not at all changed. Only the way of teaching is also not changed, but nothing has changed. The teachings of our teachers, our teachers, they combine spirituality with science, social, and their respective subjects. They combine science and spirituality, they combine social and spirituality, and make it interesting for us.
So that's what, so the medium maybe have changed, but then I think the, and when we observe, especially during examinations, when I hear from my colleagues, my friends, they say that they have, the schools have charged them extra fees because it's turned online and they have to pay it to the online, you know, the party that provides them the service. Whereas here, it's so amazing that Bhagwan's institution is doing the best of it. And if I should tell you, they are using Microsoft Teams, one of the most reliable portals for education portals. They're using that with no cost, absolutely as usual. And then teachers give their best to, you know, explain the students in case they have doubts. They're also available on WhatsApp. You know, they can message them the doubts at any point of time in the day. And it's so amazing. Whereas when I hear my colleagues, they say they're available only from 9 to 4. And after that, you can't even ask them doubts. But they charge them so much. It is so amazing. So what can we actually give back to such a massive work that the institution does, people, our teachers do? As students, what could we give back to them? So that's one thing that we keep pondering. How much ever we do, how much ever we are, like, we contribute physically, financially, service oriented, anything that we do, we feel it's just nothing. It just can't, you know, compensate a bit of what we have got from Swami. And when we take up service activities as a part of our samiti, as a part of our organization, alumni group, I feel there's just nothing that we do in return. Whatever Swami has given us is only for us to think and uplift ourselves to receive what He has come to given us, right?
Yes. So Swami always says education is for life, not for living. So after He imparted the value-based education, the highest quality education combined with the values, so it helps us in many ways. And you know, how shall we pay? Repay back Swami. And the only way that I believe that, you know, and Swami also agrees that only way that we could repay back Swami for whatever that we have got is to convert the learning into societal service. Swami always says that, you know, Swami always, there is a twinkling eyes that we could see in Swami whenever He sends the Grama Seva vehicle with the alumni packed within. And that's a brilliant, video that we could see always.
Thing I wanted to interrupt. So when we were in Grama Seva, we were a part of Grama Seva activity. So the girls were given the packing work and brothers used to send it, go to the villages and distribute it to the people, the beneficiaries. So when we were given this packing work, we used to stay up whole night, do the packing, but we had to really finish it by 3:34 max so that brothers could take it and deliver it. So we used to stay up overnight, do the packing, and we used to sing bhajan. Some of us would doze off and sisters would just wake us up. It was such a beautiful experience, but that time I never thought that it would come a few sometime later in my life. Now when we are a part of Sai Amudam, Satya Sai Amudam, which is a new project taken up by Satya Sai organization, where we provide home cooked food to the COVID patients who are in quarantine. So when I cook and pack food for these people, I keep singing bhajans and then cook food, pack. So I know the way to pack so that there is no spilling of the food. So everything that we learn, every moment of our time that we spend at Bhagwan's lotus feet is a learning. Learning for the entire life. We never know when it would come of use to us, right?
Yes. So one of the things that was mentioned by her is Sai Amudam project. So I'm sure you would have to understand from the WhatsApp forwards. So being a part of this Sai Amudam project, so we, from the alumni circle, we do a lot of service activities. Right now, the one is worth mentioning at the current scenario is Sai Amudam project, which the alumni works in tandem with the Satya Sai organization. So we share the cooking with the devotees who are all volunteering for that cooking. So we finally pack all those cooked food and we keep that on one particular point after place like Samadhi, and we distribute. So we tend to get requests from across all mediums, like we have web pages designed for it, and we do have send those flyers that was created by the Satya Sai organization to all the known circles, thanks to WhatsApp and Facebook. So we get requests from all the corners through various mediums. So we plan that, we cook the food, and we keep that in front of Swami, pray for patient's recovery, and we literally deliver that doorstep. So this is the delivery is the most challenging part, because it is very sensitive as well, because there are certain houses where it is quarantined. The entire street is quarantined. Believe me, you know, those people who are asking for food, they might be devotees, or they might be non-devotees as well. So we keep, Vibhuti packet, Swami's photo, and Sanadana Sardi, for those who wanted to know more about Swami. So we keep a copy of Sanadana Sardi as well, and an enrollment form, wherein if they wanted to enroll for Sanadana Sardi further editions, so they can also always do that. So we keep all these things and keep it as a kit and deliver it at the doorstep. So when we go to the doorstep, so we don't disturb them, and we call them and they come, we keep it at one particular place and we leave. Until we leave, until they come, we'll just stand at a distance and check whether they are able to take the prasadam inside. So after that, we leave that particular place. So likewise, we deliver this food for the quarantined COVID patients. And apart from this, the alumni, we are also engaged in various other activities. Like, there is a severe shortage of hospital beds. People, we hear from the WhatsApp group. So very, very sad to hear that people are in need of oxygen, O2. There is a dip in the O2 levels, and they are in the streets for the night until they get the hospital beds. So that is the situation. So what we do is we create a helpline and make sure that all the patients who are reaching out to us are given hospital beds. We use various kinds of influence, and of course Swami is helping us to get this done. And so we arrange hospital beds, and we also arrange oxygen cylinders. Now there is a severe shortage in oxygen as well. Now we got to understand yesterday that Satya Sai Trust Tamil Nadu has procured oxygen concentrators, and the machine has reached to Sundaram. So now, as a part of the alumni activity, all the volunteered alumni will be trained on functioning of that oxygen concentrators, and we will be implementing those oxygen concentrators at the required place. And that is something that we have taken. So these are all the various initiatives, especially for this particular time. Apart from this, we also do Narayana Seva. So we identify certain pockets of region where there might be payment dwellers, where they don't get food at all, and they need to depend on with everyone. So they live in the payment, no one to take care. So we search and provide food packets. Now they rest assured, whenever they receive the pockets of food or prasadam in their hand, they know that it's a Sunday, because we deliver it to them on Sunday. So even though they don't go by the calendar, they would say, whenever they see us, okay, now today is Sunday, they have come. And likewise, they provide that nice gesture. So these are all the various activities that the alumni does. So these are all the various service activities that we do. And like I said earlier, this is the only way, you need to enter into the society. After Swami had given you everything, whatever that you want. Now what Swami expects from us is, you need to get into the society and head in the forest. So that is something that we believe that, we should be doing in order to give back a little to Swami for whatever that he had given to us. So with this note, thank you so much for the wonderful opportunity that the entire team and the participants have provided us in the midst of all that we are going through. And thank you so much, and really blessed to be a part of this wonderful satsang. Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. This 1 hour, I think we have simply dwelt in the thoughts of Swami, going back to our college times and thinking of Swami's, thinking of these experiences, recollecting these experiences. Is a wonderful moment for us too. Thanks for the opportunity.
Sai, we cannot let you go without a few more bhajans, Sai. How is that possible?
And you can bring your harmonium if you want to. We have time. Yeah. Couple of bhajans. Go for it. Whatever comes to your mind, what is your favorite that you would like to sing? Just go for it.
Sai Baba Gita Sudha Madhuram Madhuram Anandam 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 Shirdi Baba Gita Sudha Madhuram Madhuram Anandam Shirdi Baba Gita Sudha Madhuram Madhuram Anandam Sai Baba Gita Sudha Madhuram Madhuram Anandam
One more and I'll leave. We'll leave you. One.
Hey Vishwanath, hey Gaurinath, hey Sainath Bhagavan. Daya karo, daya karo, daya karo Bhagavan. Vishwanath, he Gaurinath, he Sainath Bhagavan. Dinadayala Saiyana Shama, Dinadayala Saiyana Shama, Patita Pavana He Sai Rama, Patita Pavana He Sai Rama. Daya karo, daya karo, daya karo Bhagavan. Daya karo, daya karo, daya karo Bhagavan. He Vishwanath, he Gaurinath, he Sainath Bhagavan.
Sai Ram, thank you so much. By any chance, were you there in the video that was made on the efficacy of the Gayatri Mantra chanting by Radio Sai?
Oh, no. I was not there. My classmates were there.
Okay.
Two of my classmates were there.
I saw you in the video. Yeah, good morning, Gayatri. Okay, wonderful. Vivek, yeah. Vivek, would you like to
say? Wonderful to hear. When we talk about experiences, nothing is too minuscule. So relating it to our daily lives, and then at the end of the day, the take home for each one of us, as you rightly said, Swami has given us immensely, and to whatever minuscule that is possible from our end is only when we get into service related activities as a sense of gratitude for what Bhagwan has done for us, in his infinite compassion that he has had for us, and for having given us the opportunity to be in his doorsteps and learn for how many ever years. Every single year is a precious thing. And the sense of gratitude, as you rightly put it, Srinivasan, is to carry out service in whatever form that we can, not just as in the current situation that we are in, but that is where, as you said, hands in the society and heads in the forest is something that we should all follow and, show our gratitude through seva activities. Pavan, anything that you would like to sum up?
I am very happy to see a family which is fully into the activities and kind of a motivational inspiration to rest of the alumni as well as other people. I really pray that their bonding is so strong. I could say that, and then they always do with full utmost devotion and dedication, which is where I see that the fruits and the grace and blessings are directly proportional to that. I am really happy that Srinivasan, especially I know him very well. So he has been my opening partner. So so I know him very well. So we used to chat a lot. I am very happy that today he has been an inspiration to his son. And I hope his son also draws a few things and takes the torch, the forward. With the this, all the best. Yeah, torch bearer. And with this, I really appreciate all three. And sister, she is a gold medalist, so nothing to say.
I forgot to mention, she is a gold medalist in her BA as well as the MA.
Grace purely. Nothing
and Vika, and at least I can't comment on the gold medalist. So.
stay on the gold.
We had a discussion on the gold medal.
No, I'm with you.
So nothing to comment on that.
But I think back to back, Swami has been blessing us with a structure about how the inspiration goes beyond the physical form. I think we had a beautiful session with Sister Priyamani, who's also here, who spoke about how she infused the values driving her son to school. We see the same thing here, and we see the next gen of alumni coming up, where I think for them it's the innate firm belief of the physicality of Swami being there without really seeing something with the eyes, but experiencing him in every moment of their activity. I think it's something that all of us should draw inspiration from, and wishing you the very best in your studies, though it's online, but I hope you too will continue to be that gem, as we call every student of Swami, to be an inspiration by the way you live your life and you inspire others as well. Thank you, all the three of you, for being with us today. Thank you, Swami, for yet another Sunday filled in your thoughts and memory. Vivek, could you finish off with 21 Samasta Lokas, please?
Thank you very much. Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you. Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. समस्त लोका सुखिनो भवन्तु 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 ओम शांति शांति शांति
जय बोलो भगवान श्री सत्य साई बाबा जी की
जय
Sairam, everyone, stay safe till next Sunday. Let's keep contemplating, not just contemplating, but have our hands in the society trying to do our little bit of whatever we can within our means. Till then, stay safe. Sairam, till next Sunday. Sairam.
Sairam. Sairam.